Now, we know you think that was pretty high-paced, but we're actually down to the earth, low energy too. So, this is Mallory.
Yeah, so my name is Mallory Hayes. I'm one of the youth interns this summer, and this is Josiah Jones.
Also one of the interns this summer. And we're excited to see what God has in store.
We are super excited for this summer, so let's go ahead and worship with one another.
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. So I could praise your great and matchless name all my days. So let my whole life be a blazing offering, a light that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God.
Glory to God.
Proverbs 6:20-23. My son, keep your father's command and do not forsake your mother's teaching. Bind them always on your heart, fasten them around your neck. When you walk, they will guide you. When you sleep, they will watch over you. When you awake, they will speak to you. For this command is a lamp, this teaching is a light, and correction and instruction are the way of life.
Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord.
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 And He will lift you up.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound
that saves. We've no less days to sing God's praise.
To the time of our service to take communion. And as I was preparing for this, thinking of this, I've just had a lot on my plate lately, a lot on my mind, a lot to do physically and mentally. And I was a little worried about what I was going to talk about. And then Ron said something brilliant. He said, just go back to the basics. And that is really what I needed to hear at that time. Maybe some of you can relate when you're getting pulled in many different directions and you have a lot of responsibilities. Sometimes it's good just to focus on the basics. So I want to read the passage of the Lord's Supper from the Gospel of Luke. Then came the day of the unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover." They left and found things as Jesus had told him, so they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I've eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." We sometimes think back on Christianity and how we're connecting to 2,000 years of history, 2,000 years of our brothers and sisters, 2,000 years of our family in Christ. And as Jesus mentions in his, when he's talking to his apostles, this really even goes back much further than that. We're thinking maybe 4,000 years now, taking it back to the beginning of the Passover, where we're recognizing God's rescue of us. Yes, it was different. Egypt, it was different in Roman-occupied Israel, but when we get back to the basics, it is God's rescue of us, even if it's just our busy day-to-day experience in North Texas. So whatever you're going through now, I just ask you to take a moment to reflect on God's love for us, his sacrifice, and his rescue of us. And that's really as basic as it gets. That's what we're doing. We're remembering his love, his sacrifice, and his rescue. Pray with me, please. Our holy God in heaven, we are so grateful to you for loving us enough to send Jesus to not only show us your love, teach us how we should treat each other, but to be that perfect sacrifice, to be the Passover lamb, to cover our sins for all eternity, to allow us entrance into your kingdom attempt to become brothers and sisters in your family. Help us to remember his broken body and his shed blood for our rescue. It's in Jesus' name that we pray.
Good morning, Oak Ridge. We've reached the point of our worship service that we refer to as family prayer time. This is a very special time where we pray with and for one another. So if you'll take out your phone and send a text message or a phone call, write a card to someone that you know about who maybe, you know, is struggling or having some difficulty, and say a prayer for them at this time. Again, welcome to family prayer time.
Stay me live. I surrender
Bye.
Welcome, Oak Ridge family and friends. Thank you for joining us for another online worship service. I would appreciate it if you would either like or comment down below the video in YouTube or send me an email at ronjohns2@gmail.com if you enjoy these online videos. We need to know that people are out there watching them. It helps us in the work that we do. And any helpful ideas that you'd like to share with us would be very, very well received by us as well. Many years ago, when I was less wise and less experienced in the matters of being married, I decided to do something I would eventually greatly regret. I found an orange and white Volkswagen Transporter, the old Volkswagen bus. This guy in the neighborhood was selling it for $400, and it ran. It had even passed inspection. I borrowed the money from a friend of mine so that I could buy that vehicle. I was so excited to get it, and I did it without ever making a mention of it to Brenda. Now, for those of you who know Brenda, you realize that was not a good move on my part. And as that vehicle cost me $200 here and $400 for repairs there, it began to add up, and suddenly I found myself with a rather expensive Volkswagen. It was not a good choice for me. And it taught me that really and truly, I wanted to be in partnership with Brenda. When I was trying to do something for the benefit of our family. Now, many years later, Brenda and I owned a big conversion van that we used for traveling with the kids. And gas prices went through the roof. Remember back when the gas was over $4 a gallon, and we decided to sell it and get something else. And eventually I ended up trying to buy a little hatchback. And I took it and showed it to the kids and they loved it. And then I took it back to the dealership and said, I'm gonna have to get my wife in here to look at it and make sure this is the one we want. You see, I'd like to think I'd learned my lesson by that point. But that salesman with very old school sales tactics said to me, well, who wears the pants in your family, you or your wife? Now, all I've got to say is it was a very good thing Brenda wasn't actually there when he said it. I pity the fool. But I did say to him, buddy, you know, I really liked this car and I had full intentions of buying this car. But I will never buy this car now. You see, there's an attitude there that disrespects the partnership of a husband and wife. It says that there should be a hierarchy where a husband is more important as a decision maker than his wife, and he doesn't need to consult with his life partner about a major decision like going in debt for purchasing a car. And that's foolishness. That's foolishness because partners work together. They think through things together. Now, I realize that the passage we're going to look at today has been argued over. There have been folks who've taken this household code in Ephesians chapters 5 and 6 as meaning that men should wear the pants in the family and women should just do whatever the men say. Well, that's become pretty rare. I remember from my childhood hearing certain preachers talk like that. But to be honest with you, I'm much more concerned about another side, another misunderstanding of this passage. I'm more concerned about the side that says people don't need to submit to each other. Men and women ought to have full rights to do whatever they want, whenever they want. And they ought to learn to accept and give each other their freedoms. I realize that's the kind of culture we live in, and that lots of folks have tried to soften the language of submission that Paul uses in this passage. But I want us to understand that Paul is calling us to live a different way than human beings normally live. And yes, while I would totally agree that Paul, just in the very fact that he says to the women, "Wives, submit to your husbands," he's recognizing that they have a choice whether to or not. And that's a step up probably in the Roman society he was writing to. But please understand, we're going to begin before the wives passage, and we want to hear what Paul has to say to us as a church. This is Ephesians chapter 5. So I'm going to actually back up and start at verse 17. "For this reason, do not be foolish, but be wise by understanding what the Lord's will is." Paul is calling us to wise living. And he pities any fools who don't learn what the Lord's will is. He says, "Do not get drunk with wine, which is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit." Paul is trying to emphasize a very important idea, and that is to be filled with the Spirit. And then he uses four participles, those ing words, those speaking, singing, making music, thanking, and submitting. And those four words seem to have a context in this passage where he's saying these are the things that begin to happen when you are filled with the Spirit. But he also seems to be saying these are the things that we do to get ourselves filled with the Spirit. Speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Singing and making music in your hearts to the Lord. Always giving thanks to God the Father for each other in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. I want us to understand that everything that follows in the household code comes out of this idea of submitting to one another. We enjoy speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. There is that opportunity, if our lyrics to our hymns are worthy, to learn as we sing together, to think about who God is and what He's done for us. And this idea of making music and singing means that we're coming together in a blending of our talents, and the whole becomes greater than the sum of its parts. As our voices blend together, we realize we're part of something that's bigger than ourselves. And giving thanks means that we are constantly reminding ourselves that God is the source of all that is good in our lives. And then we submit. We're submitting to each other out of reverence for Christ. And this is the model, this is the pattern that Paul's going to use through the rest of the section we're looking at today. Paul is saying, as you are submitting to each other, you're being filled with the Spirit, and the Spirit is enabling you to be submitted to each other. It's a powerful idea. Let's look at what it is that he begins to share. We're not going to read every single verse, but I want to get the flavor of what's going on here, and notice that there's a pattern Paul establishes. "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, because the husband is the head of the wife." Now, as those words come out of Paul's lips or off his pen, they sound a lot like the household codes that Greek philosophers and Roman philosophers had been teaching the people for decades, maybe a century. As they began to talk about this patriarchal hierarchy where The father is the head and of the household, and everyone else submits to the father and the father's will. But notice what Paul does. He says, because the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, he himself being the savior of the body. Now, if we're giving thanks to Christ in the Eucharist, in our communion time, then we're beginning to understand that Paul is calling husbands to a different kind of headship. He's calling husbands to a relationship of self-sacrifice and giving up their lives for their wives. In fact, he goes on to say, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her to sanctify her by cleansing her with the washing of the water and the word. And what I want you to understand as we think about this is, yes, he says, okay, husbands, you have power in our culture, in our society, in everybody's family, in this church group. We realize that you guys have all been taught that you're the head of the house, that you are the head of the family. And wives, you've all been taught that you have to submit to your husband and do whatever he calls you to do. Paul begins to say, wives, I don't want you to obey your husbands in order to keep the peace, in order to mirror our common culture. He says, wives, I want you to choose to submit to your husbands, lifting them up in honor as you lift up Christ in honor. Serve your husbands the way you serve Jesus. And the way we serve Jesus is in a loving relationship of giving and receiving from Jesus. Then Paul says that this model that he's first illustrated with one example of husbands and wives, this model, he says in verse 32, this mystery is great, but I'm actually speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Paul is saying that Christ is the husband of his bride, the church. So as we go through the rest of this, I need you to understand that we're talking about our church family, and that all of us together as a family of faith, we are the bride of Christ, and we are called to submit to each other, Paul said, out of reverence for Christ. We are to submit to each other. We are to give up our will for the benefit of the family of faith. We are to care about the relationships we have with each other so that when someone gets in trouble, we make the investment to help them get out of that and back to shalom, because we've got a rugged commitment to be with them and for them. It means when someone is grieving, we step into and share in their grief. As someone weeps, we weep with them. It means that when someone is celebrating, when they've had a great success and good things are happening in their lives, we certainly celebrate with them as they are celebrating, not holding and harboring in our heart jealousy for their good fortune, but rather recognizing that the God of our God and Father above, our husband Jesus Christ, has brought blessing into our whole family, even as he has brought it into one. And we share it together. Paul says this mystery is great. I'm not just talking about it working better between husbands and wives in your families. I'm talking about it work life being better, living with wisdom as we as a family of God, as the family of faith, move forward together. He follows the same pattern as he goes into chapter 6 with an exact same ideas. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, accompanied by a promise, namely, that it may go well with you and that you will live a long time on the earth. Paul is saying, children, I don't want you to just obey your parents because they can discipline you and it can be hard for you if you don't. Paul says, I want you to obey your parents because God told you to, and because honoring your parents honors God. And then God gives you good life, a life well lived in wisdom, and a life that is long and blessed. Paul is reminding these children to choose to submit to their parents and to give them honor. But then he turns to the fathers and he says, fathers, I know that our culture tells you you're above your children and you can whip them into shape anytime you choose. But he says, don't exasperate your children. Don't frustrate them. Don't, the NET Bible says, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but raise them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. This phrase, raise them up, in the Greek, it actually says, raise up them, raise up. It says, elevate them, elevate. This is saying, fathers, your job is not to just discipline them so that you can show them who's in charge, who wears the pants in your family. He's saying, fathers, your job is to help your children to grow up, to be elevated, to maybe even rise above you in their status because you have worked hard to help them grow. You have worked to cause their lives to flourish. You have made a rugged commitment to be with and for your children as they reach shalom in their lives. And with that example, Paul adds yet another one, one that radically shakes the Roman household codes. Because though many Roman and Greek philosophers would have said, slaves, obey your masters, they don't ever say it this way. Slaves, obey your human masters with fear and trembling, in the sincerity of your heart as to Christ. This is three times now Paul has said, we are submitting to each other out of reverence for Christ. We are submitting to each other because we are submitted to Jesus. Not like those who do their work only when someone is watching as people pleasers. Slaves, don't obey your masters just to avoid a beating. Slaves, don't obey your masters just because you like to get positive attention from them. No. But as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. And so a slave is told, when your master says, go out there and chop that wood, split it into firewood, you say to yourself, as I am going and serving my master, I am giving this work as a gift to Jesus Christ, who gives me the health and the strength to do the work. Do you see the shift? Now, these are just three examples, but they are powerful. Now, he goes on to say, because you know that each person, whether slave or free, if he does something good, this will be rewarded by the Lord. Notice Paul is up in the game here. He begins to say to the slaves, as you look at your masters, whether they treat you well or not, and you honor them and you respect them and you give them dignity, as you choose to love them with a rugged commitment to be with them, for their flourishing, the way Israel was to be for Babylon's flourishing, so that shalom would come to everybody. If you do this, you will be rewarded by the Lord. And notice that Paul has set the slave and the free on an equal footing, saying that those who do good will both be rewarded by the Lord. And then he turns to the masters and he says, masters, treat your slaves the same way What same way? As though you are treating the Lord. What? What? Is Paul saying to masters, submit yourselves to your own slaves out of reverence for Christ? Is that what in the same way means here? I really recommend you go spend some time with this passage because he goes on giving up the use of threats. Because you know that both you and they have the same master in heaven. It sure sounds like what Paul is saying is that masters should look at their slaves and treat them as though they are masters over Jesus Christ and yet submitted to Jesus Christ. It is a strange irony of what he's saying here. How would you treat Jesus if Jesus were your slave? How would you treat your slave if Jesus were standing here as your master and his master? What if this slave belongs to Jesus first and not to you first? It changes everything. Suddenly, the master finds himself surrendering his will to the well-being of his slave. And Paul adds, you have the same master in heaven and there is no favoritism with him. I'm blown away by that picture, by this idea that Paul would call the masters to see Jesus even in their slaves. And to think about Jesus being master of both of them, to think about how they would treat their slaves if Jesus were present, because he is. And yet, it all comes together to say this. Everything we're doing is out of reverence. It's out of submission. It's out of respect. It's out of love for Jesus Christ, our Lord and Master. Now, listen to me, church. This is not easy for us. This is not easy for us because we live in a culture that says, be you. You do you. Don't let anyone else tell you who you're supposed to be. We live in a culture that is constantly telling us, if you don't like the way things happen at this store or that store, go to another one. Choose a different brand. If your Nikes fall apart and you want to wear Pumas, go for it. Because you should get what you deserve, and it's all about us. It's all about getting what we want, what we should do and be out of life. And I want to say to us very clearly, we're submitted to Christ. Paul says in Galatians chapter 2, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives through me. And the life that I once lived, I now live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. You hear the mutuality of submission. You see, Jesus submitted. Jesus emptied himself, Philippians 2, and came in the form of a bondservant, being made in likeness as a man to the point of dying on the cross. Do you understand? It's a mutual submission, even as the head of the church, even as the husband of the bride of Christ submits his life to us. We submit our lives back to him in service to him. And Paul says the mystery is great, but as a church family, we submit to each other out of reverence for Christ. Let me say this very clearly. When there's trouble in the church family, when there are work days to be done, when there is service to be given, when there's Sunday school classes to be taught or June camp to be worked, do you understand? We give up some of our things that we would do. We give up some of our time and energy and talent, and we invest it into each other because we are submitted to one another out of reverence for Christ. We serve at the Center of Hope together. We work changing attitudes and circumstances in shopping lines, at grocery stores, and in schools. We together, out of reverence for Christ, care for each other and help each other care for our neighbors out of reverence for Christ. The most important part of the concept of family in the Holy Scriptures is the idea that being part of a family means I'm no longer an individual who insists on my way, but rather, I am an individual who brings my gifts, my talents, my time, my resources to share with a family of faith so that together we can make an impact in this world and culture for the Lord Jesus Christ, expanding the kingdom of heaven and growing the church. In the month of June, we're going to talk about what it means to be the church. We're going to look at this word, church, which in the Greek for the New Testament is ekklesia, the called out assembly. And we're going to talk about what it means to be called out by God and formed into a community of faith, a family of faith, the kingdom of heaven. I hope you'll join us through the month of June as we begin this new study. May God be with you, Oak Ridge, until we can all be together again. Shalom.
Good morning, Oak Ridge. Hope you've enjoyed this morning's services as much as I have. Here's our benediction reading from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 through 17 in the Message. Make the master proud of you by being good citizens. Respect the authorities, whatever their level. They're God's emissaries for keeping order. It is God's will that by doing good, you might cure the ignorance of the fools who think you're a danger to society. Exercise your freedom by serving God, not by breaking the rules. Treat everyone you meet with dignity. Love your spiritual family. Revere God. Respect the government. Have a great day. Love y'all.